Everyone, good evening. Those that are tuning in virtually, good evening to our community members and neighbors. Thank you for being here. We're going to begin our meeting for this evening. So I want to call this meeting to order. And we're going to begin with the invocation. So we're going to remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance to follow after the invocation. Nancy, it's great to see you. The floor is all yours.
Good to see you. Thank you very much. Good evening, Reading City Council members, distinguished guests, and citizens of Reading, Pennsylvania. It is with heartfelt sympathy that we at Transformative Solutions Network join with all of you in the mourning of Mr. Waltman's untimely passing. We also celebrate with you his life, his work, his love, his compassion, and his patience, his willingness to get involved and be involved in the city which he loved so much. He gave untiredly of himself. His sense of humor and his servant leadership caught my attention, and I sat admiring his ways, and I learned how to address a board. He led the city well. Ladies and gentlemen, we turn our attention to our Lord, for it is in him that we find wisdom to lead the city into wholeness and oneness in him. I will read out of 1 Chronicles chapter 16, verse 11. Search for the Lord and for his strength. Continually seek him. Father God, you have made yourself very clear. As we continually seek you and your direction for this city, you will show us your way. We thank you for your continued peace and righteous guiding into all matters and oneness of your spirit as we work together for this city. I thank you, Father God, for these council members who work for the people to bring about a good change and a promise and a hope for tomorrow. Your foundation has been laid by the Lord, and we thank you for your continued guidance through your Holy Spirit, your guidance to bring all things and all peoples into your mighty presence as you bring this city together in your peace and in your righteousness. Lord God, thank you for continuing to show us your ways. We only have the victory when we walk in your victory. We come together and we thank you, Lord, in prayer, knowing that all these things have been heard in heaven, in your Son's name, Jesus. Amen.
Okay, at this point, we don't have any proclamations or presentations. We're going to proceed with public comment. Oh, I'm jumping right into the meeting. I apologize. Let's do roll call first, please.
Here.
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 Here. Ms. Reed?
Here.
Ms. Ventura?
Here.
6 present, none absent.
And just for the record, we did have an executive session regarding personnel matters earlier before the start of this meeting. We're going to proceed to proclamation presentations. We don't have any at this time. Therefore, we'll proceed with public comment. But before we do so, if Councilwoman Reed can provide instructions. Thank you.
Sure, be happy to. Thank you. To comment at a regular business meeting, citizens can register by calling or emailing the city clerk's office by noon on the day of the regular meeting. Instructions to access the virtual meeting app or dial in are provided upon registration. The council number is 610-655-6204 or email council@readingpa.gov. Public comment for regular business meetings will also be accepted in writing by 4 p.m. on the day of the meeting through an email to council@readingpa.gov. The message must be clearly marked as public comment. The comment received in writing will be read into the record at the regular meeting. Those wishing to provide in-person comment at the regular meeting must register no later than 4 p.m. with the city clerk or here at the city council chambers by signing the registration sheet before the start of the regular meeting. Public speaking rules adopted by council allow those speaking on agenda matters to speak for 5 minutes and 3 minutes for non-agenda matters. Comments posted in Zoom chat and on Facebook are not comment and a response may not occur. All remarks must be directed to council as a body and not to any individual council member, any public or elected or appointed official in attendance. Any comment that is personally offensive or impertinent will not be read into the record. Comments on agenda matters, again, are limited to 5 minutes in length, and comments on non-agenda matters are limited to 5 minutes in length.
Thank you, Councilwoman Reed. And at this point, we're going to get started with our public comments. The first one, Ryan Lena Weaver. Did I pronounce that correctly? Or is it Lina Weaver? Okay, great. You have up to 3 minutes. It's an agenda item. I'm sorry. Yes, 5 minutes. All right. Thank you. Go ahead.
Better? All right. So my neighbor, I'm the current president of Westing Borough Council. This evening to ask for your help and offer ours in return regarding an issue that affects not only West Reading residents, but the residents of Reading, Wyomissing, and Lower Elsass townships. As you're likely aware, for years now, large and raucous gatherings have disturbed the peace in and around the greater Reading area. In the past, the attention was centered on problematic areas around Mount Penn and the Pagoda. But now, unfortunately, since 2019, the Schuylkill River waterfront has become the latest target for occurrences to arrive. And to my understanding, Mount Penn and Lower Alsace is still dealing with an issue on the east side of town as well. We've been dealing with hours of deafening music flowing unabated across the river and into West Reading and beyond, sometimes daily. I know that I called at least 3 days in a row back in May, and we had a member of council call at least five times within a week for issues down on the river. Yesterday, and quite frankly, on most Sundays, loud blaring music roared across the river for a full 4 hours from 4 p.m. to 8 p.m., only to stop when the threat of rain was too close to risk damaging valuable stereo equipment, some of which, by my estimates, about 10 feet wide, top of a Honda CRV. So calls have been placed to the Reading Police Department numerous times. Emails have been written to city leadership and administration. And most recently in February, West Reading and Wyomissing felt no other choice but to notify the city through a certified joint letter that the city of the exact locations where these events frequently took place as a means to help address the problem. Since then, the noise has only gotten worse as the weather has grown warmer. These noisy gatherings take place on private property owned by Reading Redevelopment Authority, with hundreds of cars illegally parked, blaring loud music, racing dirt bikes, other potentially dangerous activities, all next to a swiftly moving body of water. No lifeguards, no safety protocols of any kind in place. These numerous violations, all concurrently taking place, seem like a recipe for disaster. So what when a drowning or an overdose or worse takes place during these illegal gatherings, and a family asks whether the city was aware of any of these risks but didn't act to ensure public health, safety, and welfare, it seems like a very large liability to ignore. The absurdity and ruckus has caught the eye of a local satire page on Facebook. They've dubbed the riverfront area as Reading's greatest vacation destination, complete with t-shirts, beach towels, and beyond emblazoned with a logo. While we're aware of the constraints currently endured by the city's police department, there has to be an answer to what amounts to the flippant disregard for the rule of law and the slow degradation of our residents' quality of life. We've received messages from residents pleading with us to do something. I had one woman reach out to me to bed because of the music blaring. We've had longtime residents whose residency dates back to almost as long as we've been a borough, that they're considering moving away from West Reading because of what's happening. We are not here to point fingers, but to partner with the city and solution. I applaud the efforts of both council members Chris Dalbert and Donna Reed, who have met with members of our council to help determine the best course of action. I also applaud the fact that our chiefs of police are currently scheduled to meet at the beginning of July. I want to encourage that spirit of partnership as we move forward towards building a better relationship between our two communities. To a large degree, you guys came to conclusions about issue happening at Bogota. She did a fine job of fixing the problems, it's a prominent landmark in Reading, but also pushed some of those problems away from the Pagoda to neighboring municipalities. CSU is to risk the futures of our sister communities and their ability to attract new investment, new residents, and new businesses. We're happy to help in any way going forward and look to city leadership to take the lead here as we build both our communities into stronger ourselves. Thank you.
Thank you, Ryan. And now we have the next person to speak is Philip Ward. I believe he's joining us virtually also from West Reading Borough Council regarding riverfront partying. And you have up to 5 minutes, Phil. Please proceed.
Hi, can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I'm not going to use the whole five minutes because most of what I have to say is echoes what Ryan has to say. And I do appreciate you giving us the time this evening to bring this to the light of day that it needs to be brought to. I can personally speak to this. I live on the north side of the borough, and it has been a real eye-opener over the last 3 years. This started in May of 2019, specifically on a Wednesday evening at 1 o'clock in the morning. And it's taken us now 3 years to try to really get a grasp around it as it's become more and more of an issue. To echo President Lina Weaver's comments, we really would like to partner with the city as possible to try to get our arms around this problem. Because what I really see it is as an economic development issue. One of the main concerns I have regarding this, the current situation in Riverfront Drive is the fact that we have an award-winning regional biking trail that goes right through that area. And I don't know if we are looking at it as the gold star recreative asset that it really is, that we can utilize in order to attract the type of residents, new business owners, new investment dollars to revitalize the greater Reading area. Because really the way I like to see it is your name is in our name. We're the borough of West Reading. So the way that the city goes, we feel that the way that the borough goes. We are inextricably linked together in our geography and our history. And to that end, we have the same goals for all of our residents. We want people to be proud of their communities. We want people to go out there and attract new residents to the area from as far away as possible to join live in our history here in Berks County. And so I feel that this is not just an annoyance. It is actually a very serious issue from a legal standpoint, but also from an economic development standpoint. And so I would hope that you look at it through that light and that lens as well as we move forward to try to find a solution together. With that, we look forward to partnering with the city on this issue. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Phil. Thank you for your comments. The next person up is Pastor Evelyn Morrison, charter amendment. This is also, and Pastor Morrison, you have up to 5 minutes.
Thank you very much. Good evening, City Council, and our guests from West Reading. I'm talking today about the process of the charter amendments. From a citizen's perspective, we had to court in order to fight the issue of a charter amendment for a term limits. And Fred, you know, he was a good opponent, but we won. And we did get the term limits agreed upon. And, you know, it's sad that citizens are not at this structure. We forget that it's the citizens, whether they come here or not, it's the citizens that run this show. But you have not allowed that. You have made decisions, you have made budget allotments and transfers, and you signed off millions and millions and millions of community development dollars. You didn't ask any citizen anything. A true academic or a scholar would have data support the decision that was made. When you work on any project that's public, to have a consensus, not the seven, but at least 1,000 or 100, to show that you went out there and you did the work other than when it's time to elect you. And you have been lazy. There's no way you can city council and not know the topics that are on the agenda and that you didn't do your homework. And that's just by the questions that you ask tells me that you're not prepared. That's for the new people. The older people, how dare you talk about ethics when you received thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars of gifts that you declared, but yet you didn't see that as unethical, and you surely didn't see that as illegal, and it was. But no one from the citizenship took you to the ethics committee. Now, let's be real here. The mayor has every responsibility to make this work. And no one should be usurping anybody's territory, responsibility, role, and authority. And every time we turn around, you're reacting, and it's very reactionary, to change the amendment to have ordinance after something has happened. You should be so proactive with the river and the sixth ward and the nuclear regulatory dump site that is your purpose here. Those people do not know that the river is contaminated. Now, how do we know that? The doctors at Reading Hospital have been treating people left and right with flesh-eating bacterial diseases. And the doctor said to the one client, "You don't have to tell me what's wrong with you. I can tell that you've been swimming in the Schuylkill River because you have a flesh-eating bacteria." And the patient said, "I've been there swimming. You need to tell me. I know." We need to be very conscious of our environment, and being post-industrial, there's contamination and radiation everywhere. So when those people who are swimming in the beachfront down at the river, when we educate them and let them know that they're swimming in contaminated water, maybe, just maybe, they won't want to go there anymore. The other issue is looking at the advisory opinions. Isn't it funny how the advisory opinions worked when we wanted them to work, but now, since they worked against us, we don't want advisory opinions anymore. How reactionary is that? And when it comes to the things that we should be concerned about, when it comes to our landmarks, people still enjoy the pagoda. But pushing and locking up, it's like being in South Africa. You got to have a pass to get through. And then it just pushes and displaces the activity to others. You're not addressing the issue. Some good fun up there on a regular basis. Make carnivals and make activities. We can be more creative instead of reactionary. So my time is up, people. I'll see you next time. And then hopefully we'll be able to talk about it. But you know what? I think the citizens have to do core more often, because your self-insurance, you're not going to be able to handle the things that the citizens are upset with. Okay? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pastor Morrison. At this time, we have an opportunity.
We have the written comments.
Oh, I apologize. There's also a written comment that will be read into record. Councilwoman Goodman-Hinderschutz.
I would just ask respectfully if Donald Pottinger would, now that he's present, Don, would you be willing to read a letter to that? Yeah, I have one.
Your eye was fair. Okay. Oh. Well, sweet, has that to Marsha, please.
Okay, thank you.
I wasn't really planning on speaking. I was going to let the letter basically speak for itself. To the mayor, city administration, I'm writing this letter representing the supervisors of Lower Alsace Township to address the issues with which both the city and the township are dealing with on Skyline Drive. As you may be aware of, the gate installed by the city at the pagoda appears to have reduced the noise issue in this area. Unfortunately, the problem seems to have migrated to List Road at Skyline Drive. A few weeks ago, Chief Ray Serafin of Central Berks Police informed the Lower Alsace Township supervisors of a weekend-long problem in this area on the weekend of April 10th. Chief informed me of the calls he and his department have responded to since that date. There have been calls on May 30th, June 2nd, 4th, 5th, 7th, and 18th. The constant problem in policing this area has always come down to staffing. Central Berks Police provides police coverage to Lower Alsace Township, and Borough, St. Lawrence Borough, and Olley Township. This does not allow for a large to handle a large gathering like the one mentioned. I understand from my days at City Hall how difficult it is for the Reading Police Department to respond to these types of calls, in addition to all the other issues they deal with on a day-to-day basis. What I believe is a hurdle that be overcome is communication between all municipalities and police departments involved. I will state that I have had no problems in reaching out to Frank Dombowski. I know you're out there, Frank. On any matter that has come to my attention, and Frank has always followed up if I left him a message. And I want to make that very clear. We all have a vested interest in our municipal borders. And I believe that is imperative to work together in solving these. We are stronger if we work together. If you have any questions regarding this letter, I can be reached at the township office. Chief Serafin can be contacted at Central Berks Police's office. I've got his phone number here. Thank you for your attention to the matter.
Thank you, Don. We appreciate everyone's comment, feedback, input, and concerns. At this time, I will open up the floor if for any comments from council. Donna?
I think I actually would like to defer this because I think he should be the lead person when it comes to the river area.
Yeah, I would just offer up thank you to our friends and neighbors from West Reading for coming and speaking truth, because what is going down along the river, and many of the people, organizers, do not seem to be local, which I am actually heartened by, because I also do not understand what justification there could possibly be to produce that amount of noise at 2 o'clock in the morning on a Wednesday night or morning. I think all of us agree that we have to do something, that we, working with the Redevelopment Authority, have to do something with that property in the first place. That's part of it. But the other part of it is for many things in the city, there, I feel like there's a lack of education. For example, things like people just sweeping into the gutters, thinking that the street sweeper will clean it up. That's a lack of education. I don't know if this is. It seems like a lack of consideration when it goes till 4:30. I'm hearing it. I'm miles away. It seems to be dependent upon which way the wind blows and the particular orientation that the speakers are. But my honestly biggest concern is that someone's going to get hurt down there, because it is a recipe. When I've checked it out multiple times, open containers, hundreds of people, the council president alluded to, a moving body of water. It seems very problematic, and we have to get a handle on this. I'm contacted probably daily by constituents of mine over in the 18th ward, not just friends I may have in West Reading. So we have to work together with as a body and as with our friends from West Reading and Lower Alsace. We're going to work with you too, Don, to get this under control. Thank you.
Donna?
And that was the purpose, Chris and I working on this ordinance. To the credit of this body, the work that was done in the administration on the dirt bikes really did seem to produce some improvements. It's still not great, but it's much, much improved. This is very, very analogous to that, but I would ask our neighboring municipalities to consider doing similar ordinances so that enforcement's on the same page, that it's uniform here, it's uniform on your side of the river, on the mountaintop, that we're all coming at this with a unified point of reference. And I was down there last night, as Chris said, I mean, it was breaking up when I was down there, and it was still, we had two police officers down there, God love them. How they could possibly deal with any potential issues there with hundreds of people, hundreds of cars, there's just no way they could effectively deal with that. And the amount of noise even then as rain was coming, the amount of trash, people just throwing trash down. I mean, where is the, you know, it's a consideration thing. And there were many, many out-of-state license plates that I saw, significant numbers of out-of-state license plates. But the bottom line is everyone deserves a good quality of life, no matter where you live, in a city, the county, farm area, wherever it is. If people are going to be turkeys and are going to act like this and really are just going to be disrespectful of the community at large, then we have to, education's important, but if the only thing that gets a point across is restriction of the areas of punitive matters in terms of maybe, you know, confiscating or having cars stationed there till the equipment is taken from those cars and the equipment is then forfeited or perhaps even destroyed as is the case of the dirt bikes if there's no proof of ownership. You know, it's not the way we want to go. It is the only way that we're seeing at this point that's going to improve quality of life. And if we are going to be each other's neighbors, then we have to be good neighbors. And that's the partnership that I'm really glad to hear all of you speak of. It's been good getting to know you and talking about these things. We all work together because I don't care where your municipal lines end. We're all Berks Countyans. We're all in this together.
And just as a follow-up, this absolutely, even if you don't hear the noise, it absolutely affects you. Think about what Councilwoman Reed just said. Of our police officers spent parked down there, not on their regular assignment. And for the majority, these are not Reading residents that are there.
Right.
And they show us all. And we need to get it under control.
Marsha?
And we know, living in the valley that we do, that one of our greatest assets is that we have a beautiful river running through the city. Here in the banks with West Reading, we have beautiful sharing with a lot of municipalities. But what we have happen is people that don't have an investment in our city. And I've seen the Facebook posts and the social media posts where people from New Jersey, from New York are encouraging to come and meet on the mountain or meet by the river. I'm sure our police officers are aware of that too. So it is an outright attempt to be able to say, this is where you're going to go, and how you have a good time is not going to have any limits set on it. So that what we see happening is there's a complete kind of public order, and it's extremely dangerous behavior. Chris and Donna spoke about the river. When I go to the Pagoda and along Skyline Drive, people are walking on those walls, driving their vehicles up to them, knowing that if they go over those walls, we're going to have deaths occurring. We've already had a death occurring where someone was pushed, unfortunately, over the wall of the pagoda. Okay, so we know that it's more tragedies waiting to have happened. And it's been unprecedented. I've been years since my childhood going up on Skyline Drive, have never seen anything happen with the volume. And it's not something that our police can easily control just because of the volume. And I get concerned and make no mistake, there is drug use going on, probably drug trafficking, definitely illegal use of alcohol. There's all the things that when you put them together are a bomb waiting to explode. So what I feel is a form of terrorism on our community. I don't want to speak lightly about this. And I feel so sad and that I can't find the solace that I've had going up and visiting the mountain, not knowing what I'm going to have on any individual occasion. And even though the police are available, when I see people walking on the wall, I feel like saying to them, stop that. But yet I'm afraid to say that to them because I'm not sure how they're going to respond, okay, that they really understand. I want to be able to say that we have the beginnings of a plan with the Mount Penn Preserve. We have a model how we can work together. We have a safety committee, but it's very stressed by everything that needs to be done. So we need to look at, it's happening in other municipalities, not only happening to us. Ours is all more well-known because of our landmarks. The things that we wanted to have to attract tourism, attract positive tourism, but they're also attracting the wrong type of tourism. Just be said, we know that these problems are occurring down on the Jersey Shore. If you watch the local media, they've had to take action. So it's not something that's unusual, but it's something we need to have a comprehensive plan. So it's all hands on deck to be able to address this with not waiting for anything to happen, not waiting for a committee to do it. Let's figure out as we leave here tonight, what are we going to do to take action steps? Because we don't ever want to be not reacting and having another tragedy occur. That's all I can say. It's just, to me, just really disheartening. The fact that I feel like I need to leave the city to have peace of mind doesn't say much for what's happening right now. But I also want to thank the police, our firefighters, both all on both sides of the river, on the mountain. They're all doing their job, but they need more help than out there right now. So let's look at what's going to happen. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you. I actually, it's a perfect segue to my comments, Councilwoman. I want to thank the police department. I don't want them to think that we're here saying that they're not doing their job. They have been being proactive and they have been going to these locations. I want to thank the audience, those that spoke, Pastor, thank you for always coming up. And our neighbors out in city council and across the street, let you know that we care. We care. I care. We care about all our neighbors, both our constituency as those that are across the street from us. I have been talking to the police department about what they can do to control it. Unfortunately, as we all know, you know, with a city with 95,000 residents and many challenges that come up throughout the summer, from dirt bikes to the music nuisance to the people outside to challenges that just cannot be everywhere, right? So we have to find a solution. We hear you. I don't want you to think that we're ignoring you. We hear you. I hear the people on Third Street. I constantly, people on Third Street send me messages, Eddie, you should pass by here. In fact, most weekends, I down by the river. I was there yesterday. And like it was pointed out, unfortunately, many of those individuals, they didn't even know who I was. They were not from here. And I tried to talk to them as to why. And I said, have you, you know, Google parks and lakes in the Commonwealth and in New Jersey? Because amazing how many people are not from our neighborhood in the river there. So, you know, all I'm trying to say is that we hear you. I would, Chief, again, I'll let you give you a report. The chief is coming back from his vacation tomorrow. That will be on top of my agenda to discuss with him what kind of proactive measures we can take additionally to what they have taken. And in addition to the ordinance that you're introducing to make sure that we have a safe and sound place to live in. So I just want to reiterate, I hear you. Thank you so much for coming out here, City of West Reading. appreciate you guys coming and chatting with us.
Thank you, Mayor. And I also want to echo, you know, I want to thank our neighbors for coming over and presenting this. I'm grateful that we're going to use this bridge to bind and bond us as opposed to divide us. And I want to just recap some of the things that I've heard from the body and from those that spoke. So I heard we need to educate our community members. I'm hearing that we have to review, revise our ordinances. More importantly, we have to enforce them. And I also heard economic development. So what I would like to propose, separate from the meetings of the chiefs regarding safety, maybe we need to put together a task force, because I think the economic development part is crucial, because if we start developing these spaces and areas, then we can regulate and monitor, right? It's attendance, and we can also raise revenue as a result, and then it's in a more controlled environment. So I really want to put it out there that put a task force together. I'm not sure who would like to initiate that, but I know that both Councilwoman Reed and Councilman Daubert had already started the conversations in terms to tackle the noise and the nuisance. But let's take it a step further. And I know this is not going to happen overnight, but if we start putting a plan together, maybe we can revitalize these areas. And then to Pastor Morrison's point, like, I would like confirmation about the water levels. And if they are toxic and contaminated, then we need to start putting up signage that is warning people as well, so that maybe that'll help people thinking twice about jumping into the river. So let's reconvene at some point. Let's put this on our agenda so that we can put together some type of group and start really talking about more concrete things that we can take care of, right? Because education is also crucial. And if we start, I guess, empowering our residents to help us get the word out and educate folks, then maybe we'll be able to get more done. Yes, Marcia.
And I think we need to build with the partners of success, but also as we do this, let's include those folks that are frequent and have them be part of the solution too. I've spent time outreaching to the folks that gather around the pagoda that come from far away. And I say, why are you coming to Reading? So we have to listen that, and it's not all negative. Some of it is positive, and we need to build on that.
Yeah, we have beautiful assets and people come to enjoy them. So I think now it's the time to maximize on those assets. Yes, Donna.
And we have to also, as we revamp the redevelopment authority, that's going to have to be one of their tasks, because that's redevelopment property at this point. We also have to learn the lessons of the past with the River Place Development Corporation and what did not happen for all the high-powered people that were there. They really let us down. They really let us down, along with the Penn Carter Initiative folks. And we're still suffering from that a decade later. And also when it comes to water quality, that's also our partners in the state have to be a part of that, because that's not just the city of Reading where the river flows through all of us. So, you know, I can't speak for the river, for the one development park area there that has been referred to, but certainly water quality is a state issue. So we need to work with our state representatives on that as well. But it does have to be a joint thing. We all do have to work together, but it has to be more than just talking about it. People have suffered for way too long, and they want to see more than this council meeting with all of us talking. They want to see something happening, as in tomorrow. So I hope we can tomorrow start something. Even though our chiefs aren't meeting till later, tomorrow it has to start, because otherwise the public look at it as they're just talking again. And that's the last thing we need.
Yes, Marcia.
Because we still have our guests with us, I wasn't going to do this until the end of the council meeting, but I just want to invite you all on Wednesday night at 5:00. We are going to raise a new flag at the pagoda, okay? Because the Patriotic Orders of the Sons of America always helps to replace that flag. I think that would be a positive, that we all come together, and even the folks from West Reading, you still see that flag from over in your borough. It's a beacon for our community. So please join us if you can at 5:00 on Wednesday.
Thank you. So we're gonna continue now with our agenda. We have approval of agenda and minutes. We have the minutes of June 13th, regular meeting, and the summations of discussion from the June 13th and 20th home meetings, and the June 21st Nominations and Appointments Committee meeting. I'm going to proceed with the consent agenda legislation. So we have Resolution A, authorizing the city solicitor to execute the acknowledgement sheets to approve the repository bids in the 800 block of Hamden Boulevard and 526 South 9th Street. Okay. And at this point, we're going to proceed with the administrative report. Mayor?
I will be delivering the administrative report this evening. So,
yes, correct. Frank, if I may, as I always do, I am very transparent of my whereabouts and give updates on the meetings and fees that I normally attend. However, in time, once again tonight, I'm going to skip that. But I do want to acknowledge that an amazing event had this weekend by performing one of the duties that are given to me as mayor, which is to officiate weddings, that I got the opportunity to officiate a wedding right at the First Energy Stadium, right off a home plate. So that was pretty unique and I think extraordinary, not your typical. And it's one of the, as I always share, one of the best part of my job to officiate a wedding and be part of someone's new journey. So I just wanted to share that that took place this weekend, but in lieu of time, I'm going to skip, all of my whereabouts, which are pretty lengthy. Frank.
Okay, Mayor. Sorry, but thank you. Good evening, members of City Council and the viewing public. I'll be providing the administrative report. This report will be a little bit more brief than usual because it's really data driven. So I'm not going to go through all the data. I'm just going to summarize a few things and for the sake of time. So I will go over some data parameters, but not many, because it's all in the report. So if there's any interest to find out more on what I share, you can find that in a report that's been provided to you. In the finance department, just to give you an idea about the IT division, they completed 387 help desk tickets in the month of May. So that's a lot of help desk tickets. Some are easier than others. Some can be solved in maybe 5 minutes. Others could take a half a day. But our IT works very hard to keep the city functioning. The city finance department's grant division provided a detailed update in the administrative report. It talks about the DCNR projects that are in progress at the city playgrounds. And it talks about closing out the grants at the courtyard. The purchasing division provides a detailed update on upcoming projects that start the purchasing process. So summertime is a very, very busy time for us because we have a lot of park and playground rehab projects and cleanup. So there's a lot of purchasing activity really throughout the year. But the list of projects that they're working on for purchasing process or playground projects. It's always interesting to look at the Citizen Service Center the weekly report on the calls that they receive. And it's always interesting to see that the number one call, 62, is a sewer backup. Oh, this is a two-week report, by the way. It's a combination of 2 weeks. But 13% of our calls are sewer backup. So the previous managing director was working with the National League of Cities on a program that could be offered to our residents to help. There's a program that they could pay into to help them address any kind of large issues. But we'll have an update on that a little bit later. Yard waste is always a big one at 53. People are always looking for recycling bins. And we want to make sure they're properly using the bins and they're not storing their laundry or something in them. So we're pretty mindful of, you ask for a bin, you get one every year or so, you can't keep calling us. So they do get beat up pretty hard in the wintertime and they do crack, but you shouldn't be calling every week. So we do keep very good track on how we issue recycle bins. So going to the fun stuff, I think it's fun. The library, Reading Public Library is always a great place to be. Spend some time in the summer. So as you probably know, the Reading Public Library summer program started on, June 13th and runs through August 13th. And the summer programs for all ages, This isn't for little kids. It's for all ages, teens, myself, elderly, from birth through adulthood. And there's in-person and virtual programming. So take a look at, go to the city website, the library's website, which is readingpubliclibrary.org, or just visit the library. You'd be amazed what you find at your local branch. So there's prize opportunities, and it's a great place to spend some of your summer. And as I mentioned before, your public work, specifically on outdoor work, has a ton of data here. So, you know, they're cleaning up graffiti, bags of litter, constantly picking up bags of litter, 70 televisions and 53 tires at sites throughout the city. That's our largest dumping item, but we've addressed it pretty good. If we can locate and grab them, we take them to the proper facilities to get properly disposed of. But 70 televisions and 53 tires, that's a lot in in 2 weeks. So upcoming. So the next administrative report will give you an update on the Reading Recreation Commission. I know the summer's already started, but to give you an update, you got Wacky Wednesday. You have a whole bunch of activities that go on all year round, but just want to remind the viewing audience what's also provided to Reading Rec Commission. So, and all activities, while they're mostly youth-focused, there are activities and opportunities possibly for all ages. And also, we recently had a program on Saturday. I don't have the report yet. A dumpster cleanup program. I don't have any data yet on that because it was Saturday. I'll be glad to provide that data. And we will give you information about Adopt a Block program. We're bringing that back in place. It used to be run by Reading Beautification. Reading Beautification is no longer, active. So we're going to take over some of those functions that used to be done by RBI, and Adopt the Block is one of them. We've already been doing a lot of work on it. So we'll be very excited to be able to provide you more updates on what we've done, what we plan to do, and how to ask everyone else to share it with others or participate directly. So that's my administrative report. I'm open for questions.
Any questions, comments? The Adopt the Block program. And I just want to make a recommendation in all these future activities and projects, let's try to keep the youth commissioners involved so that they can play a role in gathering and identifying community members so that they can partake in this project.
Yeah, Will. I mean, Councilwoman, it is a practice of ours moving forward for the last month and a half that whenever we do any function activity, we communicate it to the commission, as well as also is to make sure that we get more participation. Thank you. Thank you, Frank.
Anyone else? No. So at this point, we're going to move on to our report from our auditor, Maria Rodriguez.
Thank you. Thank you, council member. Good evening, everyone. My report tonight is the real estate transfer task. As some 2022. During the month of May of 2022, $883,522.83 in revenue was recorded for this line item. And this amount includes a total of 229 real estate transfer transactions, of which 200 were taxable and 29 were not taxable transactions. For the current year, $5 million was budgeted for this line item. And as of May 31st, 2022, $3,708,529.63 has been recorded. Also, during the month of May of the current year, 5 properties were sold for more than $500,000 threshold. The second item is the business privilege tax and business privilege tax prior year as of May 31st, 2022. For the current year, the city budgeted a combined of $1,789,600 for business privilege tax and business tax prior year line item, which is $323,200 increase over the 2021 budget for item. And as of May 31st, 2022, the city had recorded $1,429,556.40 for this, for the business privilege tax and business privilege tax prior year. which is $334,581.88 more than the revenue that was recorded during the same period of time of 2021. So in 2021, for the same period of time, only about 1 million was recorded, and now we have recorded 1.4 million. The miscellaneous items, the city was granted by the federal government $61,134,970 for the American Rescue Plan Act. $30,567,485 was received on June 10 of 2021. And the same amount was received just received on June 16 of 2022. This is my report for tonight. I'm open for any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Maria. Any comments or questions? I think that's great news. So now we've obtained all of the ARP funding, right?
Yes.
Excellent. Thank you. Anyone? No? Okay, so we're going to move on to ordinances for final passage. So we have some pending legislation. I will read it for the record. Bill number 49-2022, increasing the salary of the finance director by $15,000 to $120,000 due to the expansion on that role as deputy managing director. This was introduced at the May 23rd regular meeting, tabled at the June 13 regular meeting. May I have a motion, please?
Move to table.
Second.
The motion, legislation has been tabled. There's no discussion at this time. Linda, may we please have a roll call?
Motion was made by Councilor Daubert, seconded by Councilor Reed to table bill number 49-2022. Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Mr. Naubert?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henderson?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Ventura?
No.
Five yeas, one nay.
Next, bill number 50-2022, amending the charter board ordinance by making various alterations, such as eliminating advisory opinions, creating an administrative body, eliminates the confidentiality of complaints, et cetera, to establish reasonable guidelines on charter board spending. This was also introduced at the May 23rd regular meeting and tabled at the June 13th regular meeting. May I please have a motion?
Move to table.
Second.
It's been tabled. There's no discussion at this time. Linda, may we please have a roll call?
Motion was made by Councilor Goodman-Henderson, seconded by Councilor Mazura, Labor 50-2022. Ms. Peter Freitas?
Yes.
Mr. Daubert?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henderson?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Ventura?
Yes.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Six yeas, no nays.
That takes us to Bill A, A Bill 52-2022, amending City Code Chapter 496, Part 2, Solid Waste by adding definitions of container, cart, slash toter, trash can, trash bag, and clarifying the set out of trash. This was introduced at the June 13th regular meeting. May I please have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Any comments? Concerns at this time. Well explained at a committee of the whole meeting. So Linda, may we please have a roll call?
Motion was made by Councilor Daubert, seconded by Councilor Reed to enact bill number 52-2022. Mr. Daubert?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henderson?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Ventura?
Yes.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Six yeas, no nays.
Next bill is 53-2022, directing the Berks County Board of Elections to place a referendum question before city voters on the 2022 general election ballot, which would amend the Home Rule Charter by allowing the capital budget public hearing to be held on the same date as the operating budget public hearing. This was introduced at the June 13th regular meeting. May I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Any comments at this time? Linda, may we please have a roll call?
Motion was made by Councilor Goodman-Henderson, seconded by Councilor Reed, to enact bill number 53-2022. Ms. Goodman-Henderson?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Ventura?
Yes.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henderson?
Yeah, I already did vote.
Yeah.
Can I vote twice?
Yes.
Six yeas, no nays.
All right, that takes us to Bill 54-2022, directing the Berks County Board of Elections to place a referendum question before city voters on the 2022 general election ballot, which would amend the Home Rule Charter sections 1102 through 1109 to replace the current referendum and initiative with a procedure in the third class city code. This was introduced at the June 13th regular meeting. May I please have a motion?
Second.
Do we have comments, concerns at this time? Anyone? Melissa? I thought you had a comment, Committee of the Whole. I don't know if you wanted to revisit.
No, I just, my comment from earlier was that I just felt like the way that the citizens petition should remain the same. I don't think anyone's going to come up to City Hall, go online, print stuff, or fill things out online. It's more convenient for us to go door to door, as we've been doing.
Anyone else? So I concur. I agree. I think that we should probably make more of an effort to educate our constituents on how to properly circulate these petitions and gather signatures. But people have a hard time coming into City Hall, so I don't know that they would come in signatures. I know that our effort is to streamline the process, correct the process, so that our city clerks don't get stuck reviewing and revising a lot of these materials, and to make it a successful process for our circulators. Anyone else? Donna?
Yeah, I find myself torn on this because I still believe in going door to door, like Melissa's saying, that's the most effective, yet it concerns me that there have been times when people who have done this, not just in the city of Reading, but elsewhere, either flagrantly don't understand, choose not to be educated on it, or don't understand the process, and then someone else bears the grief about it. So I really, in this particular one, I see both sides of the coin. And I guess I defer to the grassroots point of reference.
Anyone else? And if I may add, because yeah, I appreciate grassroots effort, but I don't know if we can task our communications department with perhaps creating a video on to properly like a tutorial. And
if I may, all of those are good recommendations, right? But we continue to remember our legislative roles, right? That's, I don't know if that's something that the Board of Elections should be taking the initiative to do, and not necessarily the city. Again, we should all be all proactive as productive members in our community. But I don't know if an ordinance acknowledging such is the right way. Again, just my own humbling opinion. I believe that this is something that should be tackled, and maybe we should write a letter, joint letter to Board of Elections and all the not-for-profit organizations that advocate for voter rights, such as Make the Road, Centro Hispano. You know, these are organizations that are continually, doing voter registrations. Well, let's also do voter education drives. And I think that's where we're a little short.
Any other comment, Marsha?
And I think we have to understand what this ordinance is. It's to put it on the ballot and to let the voters decide. So I think this is, we vote for it to go on the ballot, then we and say, if we really trust the folks to be able to say, there's different ways you can petition, and this way is one way, and this way is another. I think we've run into too many obstacles in the past, but I'm sort of torn on this too, and I'm thinking I'm going to leave it for the voters to make a decision, as they have on many other referendums.
Anyone else? All right, maybe please have a roll call.
Motion was made by Councillor Reed, Councillor Butler, seconded by Councillor Reed, to enact Bill Number 54, 2022. Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Ventura?
No.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Ms. Zepeda Freitas?
No.
Mr. Daubert?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Hinderschitz?
Yes.
4 yeas, 2 nays.
The next bill is 55-2022, directing the Berks County Board of Elections to place a referendum question before city voters on the 2022 general election ballot, which would amend the Home Rule Charter Section 404A-B, requiring council approval for the termination of the managing director. This was introduced at the June 13th regular meeting. May I have a motion?
Second.
No discussion. This bill has been tabled. May we please get a roll call, Linda?
Motion was made by Councilor Goodman-Hinderschitz, second to enact, oh, to table bill number 55. Ms. Ventura?
No.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Ms. Zepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Mr. Daubert?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
5 yeas, 1 nay.
Next bill is 56-2022, amending the City Code Chapter 180, Part 7, Section 702.8, licensing by adding the annual licensing fees at their current rate. Master, $90. Journeyman, $50. Appliance installer, $50, reciprocal, $100, plus the fee for classification being reciprocated. This was introduced at the June 13th regular meeting. May I please have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Any comment, discussion at this time? Okay, Linda, may we please have a roll call?
Motion was made by Councilor Daubert, seconded by Councilor Reed to enact Bill Number 56-2022, which establishes the annual licensing fees in the electrical code. Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Ms. Zepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Mr. Daubert?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Ventura?
Yes.
6 yeas, no nays.
Next bill is 57-2022, amending the 2022 Fund 47 ARP fund budget to provide the funds needed for the Mayor's Summer Youth Initiative Program expenditures. The funds will be made available by a budget appropriation in the city's 2022 ARP fund budget. This was introduced at the June 13th regular meeting. May I please have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Floor is open for discussion. Any comments at this time? Marcia.
First, a comment about the process that even though there's a group of proposals that the council, as well as other members of the community, are reviewing, this is not included in that. It's a separate allocation of the ARP money. And even though, and I must be sincere with you, Mayor, I wasn't exactly 100% thrilled that it was the mayor's initiative, but I sort of thought I understand why you wanted to be able to have it that way. The important part of it, though, and as I come off of spending a week with my prevention colleagues and learning about how important connections to the community are in being able to reduce both youth violence and substance use and all the related problems, giving this opportunity for youth to feel connected to the community through jobs is so important. And we sometimes look for complicated answers to problems, and really this is a protective factor which can indeed and has been proven these type of programs to reduce some of these problem behaviors. And so I fully support that, and I think we need to look at the outcomes, but I think you'll be really pleased is once we get our youth engaged, and we often talk about that through the Youth Commission, this will be a broader number of youth that can get engaged activities.
Anyone else? I'm also looking forward to this program being implemented because I think a lot of our community members have been asking for something, right? For something for our youth to be engaged in. So this will provide an employment opportunity for some of our young people developing leadership skills, professional skills, and land them a potential job with our city when a bunch of vacancies. Mayor, you just want to say something?
Yes, exactly. I think you hit the nail. You hit the nail on exactly what I wanted to say, that this is not just a job opportunity. There's plenty of jobs, but but this is a learning experience. Also a way to engage our youth into city government. Something that unfortunately I see way too often, even when I was a school board member, was that many of our youth that go for post-secondary education will leave the city for their education and not return because they were not introduced to opportunities within the city. This is one way to introduce them to opportunity cities. In addition to, in fact, those that don't go for post-secondary education, there's a lot of opportunities in city employment that don't require post-secondary education. This will be a way to also engage them into employment opportunities in the future. Lastly, but not least, you know, just like the parking situation, like the noise situation, like the violence situation, you know, we cannot talk about the problem. There is a way to engage our youth to be occupied and outside of the streets. Thank you.
Yes.
One thing I feel that needs mentioning is that this also provides a financial literacy piece, which I think is really, really critical. And it's something that all of Reading youth, whether they go to Berks Catholic or any of the other non-public schools or public cyber charter, whatever, that all Reading youth are eligible to apply for. So thank you.
Any other comments? Okay, Linda, maybe please have.
Motion was made by Councilor Goodman-Hinterschitt, seconded by Councilor Daubert to enact Bill Number 57, 2022, to fund the Summer Initiative Program. Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Mr. Daubert?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Hinterschitt?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Ventura?
Yes.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
6 yeas, no nays.
Next bill is 58-2022, authorizing the conveyance of 513 South 14 and a half Street to the RPA to be used as residential parking. This was introduced at the June 13th regular meeting. May I please have a motion?
So moved. I apologize.
Second.
The floor is open for discussion and comments at this time. Go ahead, Marcia.
Okay, and if you could just for a minute, I just want to speak to when I moved in a half a block away from the site, and there was a vibrant pool that was operated on a private basis by community members. It was well attended. It was just the core of the community. And what happened, as many neighborhoods throughout the city, there were transitions, people moved away, people stopped putting swimming as a priority. There was nothing we could do to control that. And eventually the pool fell into serious, serious neglect to the point that it wasn't usable. There were large cracks in it. The retaining wall started to crack. And in the meantime, more and more people in the neighborhood with multiple vehicles. So that at this point, I can say to you, honestly, when I return home tonight, I probably will have to park at least 3 blocks away from my home, just because of the fact we have large vehicles, very congested. People park illegally, they park at corners. And so it was a hard decision. And when some of my neighbors that were passionate about the pool came to talk with me about it, I looked at the condition, and I know we talked about cost shouldn't be a factor, but the reality is it's not only cost, it's the capacity to be able to take something that has been sitting there empty for at least 15 years and to be able to say that can be brought back into a usable pool when there isn't even enough parking for the residents. So it's a hard decision. It's probably one of the hardest ones. I have to say that I agree with this resolution, but I also, in looking at that, want to work with the Recreation Commission to create on Never, which is a huge area. We can create a spray park up there. It won't be the same as the pool, and then work with my fellow council members to find the ideal solution to where a location for a pool. This is very unusual. This pool is location is in a very steep slope. It wasn't the ideal place to put it. It wasn't an ideal place to retain it. But just a little bit of trivia, James Caan did swim in that pool when they made the movie Rabbit One. So it does have a unique amount of history, and I hope some way we can designate that when maybe it can be the Rabbit Run pool. I don't know. Or Rabbit Run parking lot, I should say. So I don't know. So thank you.
Anyone else? All right. Thank you, Marcia. I mean, that you know the needs better than any one of us of your district. So I'm going to follow your lead. Yes, Donna.
And I think it's critical when you look at the only pool being the Schlegel Park pool. And if I lived in that part, well, even our district of District 5, but there's no way that that's convenient or safe for kids to walk to go to. We have to really reconsider. And the reason that pool failed, and many people stepped up to help, including the council that predates us, including the Chamber of Commerce, including many people, it was the financials of that were poorly, if not occasionally, I believe, criminally run. And that contributed to the downfall as much as the physical location of that pool. I understand this is a very tough decision, and it's a vote that I'll be making with thoughts of our past council president in mind. And it's not an easy vote either way.
Mayor?
Thank you. And I don't want to sound redundant in my comments to different introductions of these bills and ordinance, but you know, we cannot impose punishment and increase fines and not listen to the concerns of the community for parking relief. You know, this is one way that we're being proactive. Okay. Yes. You know, if you ask me about recreation, you know, I was one of the founding members of the Reading Recreation Commission. I was one of the first ones involved with the Reading before it's even a school board member. And the youth is huge for me, and activities, recreation is huge for me. In fact, I don't want to give my age up, but in the 80s, when I grew up back in New York, a lot of these activities I look forward because they kept me out of trouble. The PALs, the pools, you know, the boxing gym, all of that kept me outside. And that's why the summer youth program was all integral for me to, you know, pass tonight. So I want to thank you for that. And I also want to thank you ahead of time for the consideration on this particular one in the hopes that it passes.
Thank you. Marcia?
And I just want to add a comment too, because I spent a lot of time talking to my neighbors about what they wanted. And of course, people like a pool, but they, the park. So I sit on my front porch, I talk to people. People probably felt like Jeff, but I want to ask you honestly, I know we say we have money, but we know how our ARP money is being committed. I'd be able to find with our budget just coming out of Act 47, whether you honestly can look me in the eye and say that you know that we're going to be locating $5 to $8 million minimum to be start from scratch and rebuild that pool. If you can honestly say that to me, that you know that you can wave the magic wand and make that happen, that you can restore the East Reading pool to what it was, then I can accept you saying that you're going to do it. Jeff Waltman's legacy fund is going to be hard pressed, and we're going to work on it to find the money to build a kiddie pool at Schlegel's Park. That's the way you can honor his memory. You think you can honestly say that you know that you can locate the money to rebuild East Reading Pool? You have to be there to have known the condition it's in and, you know, to see what's happened to it over the years. So I just feel I want to be honest about it. It's not ignoring what the neighbors want. It's not trying to relive the past. It's being done what's realistic and what the neighborhood needs.
Thank you, Marcia. Linda, may we please have a roll call?
Motion was made by Councilor Goodman-Hinderschitz, seconded by Councilor Daubert, to enact Bill number 58, 2022, which authorizes the conveyance of 513 South 14th and a half street to the RPA for residential parking. Mr. Daubert?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
No.
Ms. Ventura?
No.
Mr. Butler?
No.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Three yeas, three nays.
The motion fails.
Moving on to the next bill, we have 59-2022, authorizing the execution of a lease agreement to convey 924-932 Penn Street to the RPA to be used as residential parking. This was introduced at the June 13 regular meeting. May I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Floor is open for discussion. Any comments at this time?
Donna? The point that this is, I believe, a year-to-year lease, and that it doesn't preclude, and hopefully there will be some strong development there in the 900 block of Penn Street. It's our main street of our city. So again, this is a use that will alleviate the parking issue as many people need, but also not not discourage future development of the parcel.
Anyone else? So again, stressing this is a temporary arrangement. Marsha, do you have a comment? I'm sorry.
I'm still getting over the last vote, okay? But I do feel that this is an issue that needs to be addressed. I'm glad it's temporary, but there is an incredible amount of congestion in that block due to 10th and Penn being across the street, and we need a place for people to park if we're gonna have that street be safe.
Let me please have a roll call.
Motion was made by Councilor Reed, seconded by Councilor Daubert, to enact Bill number 59, 2022, which authorizes the execution of a lease agreement for residential parking at 924, 932 Penn Street. Ms. Goodman-Henderschitz?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Ventura?
Yes.
Mr. Butler? Ms. Freitas?
Yes.
Mr. Daubert?
Yes.
Six yeas, no nays.
Moving on to Bill 60-2022, authorizing a budget transfer in the amount of $250,000 to cover expenses related to the settlement of matters in litigation. This was introduced at the June 13th regular meeting. May I please have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Floor is open for comments, concerns, questions at this time. Anyone? No? Linda, may we please have a roll call?
Motion was made by Councilor Reed, seconded by Councilor Butler, to enact Bill number 60-2022, authorizing a budget transfer in the amount of $250,000 to cover expenses related to settlements of litigation. Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Ventura? Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Mr. Daubert?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henderschitz?
Yes.
Six yeas, no nays.
Bill 61-2022, authorizing the council solicitor and city solicitor to accept as full and final payment for all outstanding city related to the property located at 148 North 4th Street loans by J&A Court in the amount of $375,000, payable no later than July 5th, 2022, and deposited by the administration into the city's general fund reserve. This was introduced at the June 13th regular meeting. May I please have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Any comments at this time? Linda, may we please have a roll call?
Motion was made by Councilor Daubert, seconded by Councilor Ventura, to enact Bill number 61-22, which authorizes the settlement of the outstanding amounts owed by J&A Court. Ms. Ventura?
Yes.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Mr. Daubert?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henderschitz?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Six yeas, no nays.
At this time, I'm gonna ask Councilman Butler to read the introduction of new ordinances. Mr. Butler?
Thank you. First one, we have A, ordinance authorizing residential permit parking from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. with a two-hour period for non-permit holders zones in the 100 block of Schiller Street, the 100 block of North 8th Street, block of Reed Street. In accordance with the City Code Chapter 576, Vehicles and Traffic, Part 4, Stopping and Parking, A, Regulations, Section 576, to 417 residential permit parking as recommended by the Reading Parking Authority. Next, we have B, ordinance amending City Code Chapter 396, Part 3, park use by providing additional authority for law enforcement agencies to act when responding to calls for service at public properties as defined herein and allowing responding law enforcement agencies to seize devices that are in violation of this ordinance for possible forfeiture and destruction. C, ordinance amending City Code Chapter 387, noise by adding references to Chapter 396, Part 3, Park Use regarding noise at city and city agency-owned properties. Next, we have D, ordinance directing the Berks County Board of Elections to place a referendum before the voters on the 2022 general election ballot, which would amend the Home Rule Charter Section 603, A through B, requiring council approval for the termination of the department directors. Next, we have E, ordinance authorizing the conveyance of 140 Schiller Street, Berks County Parcel ID number, I don't gotta say all that, right?
No.
Okay. From the Reading Redevelopment Authority and execution of their agreement of sale of the property for nominal consideration as per their agreement of sale. Then we have F, ordinance transferring $10,100,000 of ARPA funding from Fund 47 to the capital projects account 34. G, ordinance amending City Code Chapter 62 Pension Part 1 Office Employees Pension Fund and Part 2 Officers and Employees Retirement System by clarifying the criteria for qualifying for a disability pension benefit. Lastly, we have H, ordinance amending the City Code Chapter 5 Administrative Code Part 2 Council Organization and Procedure by creating a new section 5 to 216 relating to the evaluation of council staff in accordance with the charter amendment approved by the electorate at the June 2020 primary election.
Thank you, Councilman Butler. I'm going to ask our city clerk to make sure that we put this on our agenda for committee of the whole so that we have plenty of time to discuss and understand what we're voting on as well. Okay, so that takes us to resolutions. So we have resolution A and B. I'll read them together. Appointing Stephen Simmons to the HVAC board and also appointing Stephen Simmons as an alternate to the fire / building code board of appeals.
May I? 1072?
Yes. The next resolution, appointing Chad Milligan to the HVAC board. May I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Floor is open for discussion and conversation. Anyone want to make any comments?
First of all, you see Mr. Simons noting two places he is in the work that he does, and I think we saw that during the interviewing process and indeed needed to be formalized through these resolutions for the appointment. Same with Chad Mulligan. So I don't think people realize how important the HVAC board is as far as really protecting the safety of our citizens by making sure all these utilities are handled correctly. So strongly support those. I don't know if you have any comments, Wes, or...
Yes, both of these two that we had interviewed during nominations, I felt they were heavily qualified and I believe they're gonna do a great job on the boards. I believe one of them was already serving. He just, you know, we have to do our due diligence to make sure, you know, they're in the system. But yeah, I can't wait to see how they do.
So at this moment, I want to say something to administration, because I know for, I think it was the HVAC board, we didn't necessarily have minutes, right? Provided so that we're on top of information, what any updates or upgrades or how to disseminate information to our constituents. So I know there's some areas that we need to improve based on our interview and conversation with these gentlemen. May we, anyone else? No. May we please have roll call, Linda?
Motion was made by Councilor Goodman-Hinderschitz, seconded by Councilor Reed, to adopt resolutions 105 through 107, which make appointments to the city's boards. Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Mrs. Pater Freitas?
Yes.
Mr. Daubert?
Yes.
Mrs. Goodman-Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Ventura?
Yes.
Six yeas, no nays.
Next resolution is appointing blank as council president. Right. Yes, Mr. Butler.
It's with my great honor that we appoint Jahani Cepeda Freitas as our next council president.
Second.
Any comments or discussions at this time? Donna.
And I'm fully supportive. I just, you know, I hope we keep in mind that while we're so happy to advance you to that, the cause behind the advancement is one of deep sorrow for this entire board. So I look forward to supporting you, and I also look forward to all of us continuing to honor honor the person that's not there, and to move forward with all the goodness and grace and leadership that he had. I know you'll do that. And I don't know that it's a cause for celebration, but it's certainly a cause for respect that we have for you, as you have stepped in throughout most of this year at a time that was, I know, a challenge to you on many levels, and you've done a really great job, and I'm very appreciative of that. So I'm very happy to support you, Jahani.
Thank you. Marcia?
And I want to thank you for putting forward what you needed to be in the leadership role. And I also know that Jeff mentored you, and he, even when he was struggling, he knew what he needed to do to pass the torch on. I think that was purposeful on his part. And I believe he's still here with us. And as I said to people, I look at the North Star, and that's Jeff. He's leading us, being consistent with us. So whenever I look at the sky at night, I know that he's there, and he's going to continue. We're going to remember his wisdom, and it's going to continue to guide us, as I know it guided you. So thank you for being willing to take on this leadership.
Anyone else? Well, I thank you. I mean, it's kind of emotional for me because, you know, we spoke every week, we text. He was a great mentor, a great role model. And, you know, I miss him dearly. And, you know, I hope to carry out his legacy and be not only to our body, but to our constituency. So thank you. Linda, may we please have a roll call?
Motion was made by Councillor Butler, seconded by Councillor Gubnenschitz, to appoint Jahani Cepeda Freitas as the new council. Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Mr. Daubert?
Yes.
Ms. Gubnenschitz?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Ventura?
Yes.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
6 yeas, no nays.
Thank you. At this time, I'd like to open up the floor for some of body. Oh, yes, Mr.
Sorry.
Gumbar.
Ms. Council President, congratulations. Before we move on, I just would like to just state in the public and for the record procedurally, now that you have filled this vacant seat, you will be serving in this role through next year's municipal election, when the council president seat will be up on the municipal election at that time. But obviously you cannot serve two elected positions at one time. So you will need to submit your resignation in writing for council to accept for your District 1 council seat.
Six.
My apologies. used to what we did a few months ago. So to submit your resignation, council will have to accept that retroactively to today at our next meeting. And then that will trigger a vacancy in that seat that council will have to. I think technically she needs to submit in writing. So that's why I'm saying to do
we'll
that.
Do.
And it would be retroactive to tonight, though. Yeah. Then you would have 30 days from tonight to fill that vacancy. And you obviously now have a vacancy in the vice president seat as well, which will need to be filled. There is no time period in the charter for that, but I would recommend you take on that task sooner rather than later.
Thank you for that, Mr. Gumbar.
I just wanted also for our solicitor or council solicitor to clarify, we have followed all the procedures set up in the city home rule charter as far as how we filled this vacancy?
That's correct, yeah. So the charter itself is silent on the filling of the council president seat. So there's no special process required for that. So you have the task of filling the seat, same procedure that you would have for any other vacancy on council. So with that, you had the option of either filling it internally through a member of council, or you had the option of going outside of council with an application process with the public. So what you did tonight by filling it with Councilor Cepeda Freitas was absolutely fine and legal and in conformance with the city charter.
And it also followed precedent within the last decade of two other fillings of the seat.
Great, thank you. Thank you for the clarity. Now the floor is open for comments on behalf of the body. Does anyone have anything they'd like to share or express at this time? Yes, Marcia.
Yeah, and I had expressed it earlier, but I do want to invite everyone to the pagoda at 5:00. And I would like the honor for our new council president to join us, because it is very touching when we replace the American flag, especially with all the turmoil that goes on at the flagpole at the top of the pagoda. There's a lot of wear and tear, and we do have the Patriotic Order of the Sons of America that always provide us with a replacement flag for all of us that can join. We want to have it replaced before the 4th of July, so we have a full flag. We're also bringing the POW MIA flag, who has similar wear and tear. So please join us for that event, and we can celebrate and look over to West Reading and be able to say that we know we're joined together through our commonalities rather than things drawing us apart. Thank you.
Donna?
And just sort of following up in that spirit of Independence Day coming up, Linda, who is now the secretary of the Burke's History Center Board of Directors, and I serve both on the History Center Board. The board did agree to loan through 2026 the Berks County Liberty Bell that had sat inside the lobby of the Berks History Center. It will now be sitting in a protective casing inside the Services Center, again through 2026, which is the 250th anniversary of the founding of the United States of America. There will be a ceremony Thursday at 10 a.m. I'm sure BCTV will broadcast it as well. But I think it's very nice that a lot of people will get to see that. And the board of the History Center, and Jahani is District 6, you represent the museum, I represent the library. So that was sort of our joint area there. I'm really glad people will have the opportunity to see that in larger numbers than maybe just being at the History Center. And also just a recognition of a program that George Mizer and retired Chief Rare did on the 50th anniversary of the Agnes flood, which was devastating to the city and really created a whole new cityscape down along the river. We talk about the river, there were many buildings and businesses down near that that went the way, and homes that went the way of the river for the flood in 1972. Many of us remember it even as young as we were. And it was quite an interesting program, and makes you the challenges of nature. Even post Blue Marsh in 2006, we had a fairly devastating flood there as well. But it's good to know history, understand history, and try to do things better. But it was a great program, and it was a good partnership with Reading Area Community College, actually sitting where the floodwaters were 50 years before. It would have been way above our heads. So it was an interesting program.
Thank you. And just for clarity on the event Wednesday, what is the time? 5 p.m. So 5 p.m. Wednesday. I want to thank go ahead, Mayor.
Thank you. Well, first of all, I want to start off by congratulating you. I'm looking forward for a healthy relationship if I had with our friend Jeff, that again, with all due respect, is going to be a tough seat to fill with his commonality of always finding common grounds. But I think you're up to the task. I honestly believe that you really are. So nothing but the best. And if there's anything I can do to make sure that, our offices, continue to coexist and create that synergy that constituents deserve, please count on my 100 support. So I'm really honored to have heard tonight that you were voted in. Moving on, want to remind everyone that there's a holiday weekend coming up, and there's a lot of activities. One of those activities is the Pride and Fills. They have home games on Saturday and Sunday, where they'll be doing fireworks show. And my understanding is that they're going to be doing a little bit more than their usual fireworks show. However, with that said, I also want to remind our constituents, our residents, our neighbors, our friends, to please practice responsibility when doing any fireworks. You know, we have to be good neighbors to one another and protect one another. You know, it's no secret that there's some ordinance out there in the state that is going to eliminate some of the fireworks that are allowed in the city. However, that has not happened yet. So I'm going to ask everyone to please practice caution and be responsible when doing the fireworks. One incident is one incident too much. One life is one life too much. One fire is one fire too much. In fact, I'm so passionate delivering this message that I would like to ask permission to say it in Spanish. So le voy a preguntar a todos nuestros vecinos, residentes, que con el fin de semana que viene, que es para celebrar el 4 de julio, y sabemos que hay muchas actividades, una de ellas es cuando el equipo de los Reading Fields tienen juegos el sábado y domingo y van a estar celebrando y teniendo petardo, un show de petardo. Pero si no pueden llegar a ir a ver a ellos, si piensan usar petardos de su propio, les voy a pedir que por favor usen precaución, porque es muy fácil hacer un incendio o perder una vida. Y no es necesario, no debe de ocurrir. Solo voy a pedir a los residentes de Reading que por favor tomen precaución cuando estén usando petardos, si tienen que usarlo. Si lo van a usar, que lo hagan en una forma responsable para que no haya ningún peligro. So once again, I cannot say that enough and loud enough. Please, let's be good neighbors. Let's be responsible neighbors. And if you have a need to have any kind of fireworks that is allowed by the state law, to please do so in a safety manner. So again, may you all have a wonderful holiday weekend. Happy 4th of July to you all. Thank you.
And again, I don't want to keep everyone any longer, but I want to thank this body for your vote of confidence. Thank you for the support. I look forward to working with you all and making Jeff proud. To everyone who's tuning in virtually via social media and to our guests who are here, Wes Redding, Don, I think left. We look forward to the partnership. We look forward to working with you so that collectively, you know, we create a better impact and quality of life for us. Please have a happy 4th of July. More importantly, please have a safe, happy 4th of July. And thank you for being present and thank you for being part of our community. Have a good night and have a great week. Mm-hmm.